Welcome to A Look Ahead. We're delighted that you've decided to join us. As you probably know, we're studying the Sabbath School lessons as prepared by the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And this particular series is entitled Discipleship. And it's a series for the first 3 months of 2014. This particular lesson is lesson number 5 for February 1 of 2014. And I'm happy to say that it's about discipling the sick, since that's what I do most of the time, or at least I wish I were doing most of the time. As a physician, I spend a lot of time working with people who are sick. But before we begin, we'd like to encourage you to get your Bibles. We'd like to remind you that if you're interested in the materials that we have available on this particular lesson, they're available on our website at theox.org. That's theox.org. And hopefully now you got your Bible in hand, we'd like to begin with a word of prayer. Our wonderful Father, we understand that you were a master at reaching everybody at the right place and at the right time with the right message. Help us to understand now what it means and how we can best reach out to those who are hurting, those who are sick, those who are dying. We ask now that you will guide us in our discussion, that what we say may be helpful to others and may be an inspiration as well. As our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Discipling the sick. It's interesting to start off with a verse found in Isaiah 53, verse 4. But he endured the suffering that should have been ours, the pain that we should have borne, all the while we thought that his suffering was punishment sent by God. We thought that his punishment was sent by God. How many Christians believe that God punishes and to what extent he punishes and so forth? So that's a background for several things in our lesson. And probably a pretty good summary of our lesson is found in the memory verse, Matthew. That would be Matthew 15, verses 30 and 31. I'm reading from the Good News Bible. Large crowds came to him, bringing with them the lame, the blind, the crippled, the dumb, and many other sick people, whom they placed at Jesus' feet, and he healed them. The people were amazed as they saw the dumb speaking, the crippled made whole, the lame walking, and the blind seeing, and they praised the God of Israel. What do you think with Jesus would do if he were here in 2013?
I have a question.
Mm-hmm.
When Jesus was healing the people, why did they praise the God of Israel? Why didn't they praise Jesus?
That's a very good question. And it fits with Matthew 5:16, where it says we're supposed to live righteous lives and people are supposed to look at us and praise God for what we're doing. So, yes, that question is raised in two spots here now in the book of Matthew. And it's a very good question. Ideally, people should see in us something of God. That's what's supposed to happen. And I presume if that were the case, they would praise God.
Do you think Jesus said, "In the name of God, I heal you"?
We don't have any places where he actually says that. I think he would be a little reluctant to say that because he was God himself. Mm-hmm. If you say, "In the name of God I heal you," it might imply that you are not God.
You know, I got to go back to that Isaiah 53:4.
Yeah.
That translation is not the best way I look at it.
Okay.
You read the first, "But he endured the suffering that should have been ours, that we the pain that we should have borne." Now the RSV says, "Surely has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows." Mm-hmm. Griefs, another rendering, could be sicknesses. Mm-hmm. And why, and the sorrows could be pains.
Yes.
And that's what he came, like the people that he was, his contemporaries. It wasn't like Adam. He was suffered the human under a human condition, but that should have been ours. There's a lot of baggage behind that statement there. Yeah. So anyway,
yeah, the word for suffering there is in the Hebrew, could mean sicknesses, illnesses,
and
diseases.
Before you leave that,
yeah.
All the while we thought his suffering was punishment sent by God, but because of our sins he was wounded.
Mm-hmm.
So that means that it was the punishment sent to him by our sins. It wasn't sent by God.
Yes. Yeah.
That part of the translation is pretty good, or at least by the way, comparison with the RSV. But that first part, I like the idea. Because as we go through the Old Testament, it's always talking about sin as a disease, and that God is offering healing, and he says, I'm your healer.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Yeah.
So, well, if that's so, how does, what's the connection between our sin and what he suffered?
Well, you're asking a huge question when you say that, and a question which Christians have gone in many directions. So let me just mention two of the major directions that Christians have gone and try to answer that question. There are those who believe that there's a real literal sense in which our sins are somehow, even though this happens, you know, couple thousand years after Jesus was here, that somehow our sins are literally taken and placed on Jesus, and so that in the Garden of Gethsemane and on Calvary and in between there, he is literally bearing the sins of the world. Literally. There are those people who believe that, and that because he bore our sins, then we don't. In other words, that's the way we get rid of our sins. We stick them on Jesus. There are others who believe that what that's really implying is that Jesus demonstrated the real results of sin. Not my particular sin, but sin in a generic sense. Every kind of sin. This is the result of sin. So my sin, all the way back to Adam and Eve's sin in the garden, those sins are the ones that lead to death, and Jesus experienced that death. And so we would look at that and say, hold on, I don't want to go there. I have a different idea. I'd like to say, God, please forgive me. And God says, I'm more than willing to forgive you. All you got to do is be willing to live a life according to my pattern, and we can forget about the past sins.
So if we hadn't have sinned, he wouldn't have had to made the demonstration?
That's correct.
If we had never sinned,
there would not have been any reason for him to come and live and die on this earth. Dennis.
If I may pitch in my two cents worth.
Okay.
I just have a hard time visualizing the transfer of sins. I prefer to look at it as God treated Jesus as a sinner.
Mm-hmm.
He treated him as a sinner, although he was not a sinner.
Mm-hmm.
So in that sense, we get to see God's role mm-hmm. in the treatment of sinners. And the other thing is that when God treats him as a sinner, like us, we step out from under his protecting hand.
Mm-hmm.
And we see the other side of the coin, that is, we see Satan and his followers abusing Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
There are two sides. There's God's role, mm-hmm. and there's Satan's role.
Yes.
If we look at sin, this condition on this earth, as kind of like a quarantine for evil.
Mm-hmm.
But inside that quarantine area, the evil has collateral damage. Even though Jesus never sinned,
mm-hmm.
bad things happened to him.
Mm-hmm.
So sin ran its course. God let, on a small scale, let sin run its course, and it consumed or killed Jesus.
Yeah.
Isn't it also, though, kind of demonstrating how things can happen to Jesus negatively so bad, and he can still forgive?
Yeah,
absolutely.
Of course. Yeah.
And that's kind of a message for us, too.
Yeah.
That even God, I mean, you can't mm-hmm. mess
yeah.
God up yeah. so much that he will get so angry at you, he won't.
Exactly. Now, this series of lessons is supposed to be on discipleship and discipling the sick. So let's move a little bit more back in that direction, although the subject would be a very interesting one to discuss. What was the purpose of Christ's healing ministry? And while you're thinking about that, think about it in light of this quotation from Ellen White, because obviously he spent a lot of time healing people. During his ministry, Jesus, this is quoting, during his ministry, Jesus devoted more time to healing the sick than to preaching. His miracles testified to the truth of his words that he came not to destroy but to save. Wherever he went, the tidings of his mercy preceded him. Where he had passed, the objects of his compassion were rejoicing in health and making trial of their newfound powers. Crowds were collecting around them to hear from their lips the works that the Lord had wrought. His voice was the first sound that many had ever heard. His name, the first word they had ever spoken. His face, the first they had ever looked upon. Why should they not love Jesus and sound his praise? As he passed through the towns and cities, he was like a vital current diffusing life and joy. And that would be Ministry of Healing, pages 19 and 20. Dennis.
I think there's several answers to that question.
Mm-hmm.
But as I was looking at this lesson, I was struck with an obvious understanding that, you know, see the data all the time. Here, Jesus is, as you've read, ministering to the sick, the poor, to making their life much better just for his having been there.
Mm-hmm.
And how in contradiction to Satan's charges back in Genesis 3 at the foot of the tree, and he's talking with Eve and he's accusing God of not being trustworthy.
Mm-hmm.
Of not acting in our best interest. This is a clear rebuttal mm-hmm. to those charges that he is acting mm-hmm. in our best interest.
Exactly.
Well, I think that sickness is a kind of a huge metaphor, kind of covers
sure.
everything. I mean, you can even look at it as when you're deceived, you know, you're in a way sick in your understanding that mm. needs to be healed. There's all kinds of ways, you know, even when you do things that aren't the best way to do them, they need to be straightened out.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, sickness can just go all
yeah.
over the place.
Yeah. Well, to realize how incredible that was, look at this passage from Spirit of Prophecies, Volume 2, 285.3, and maybe not everybody's familiar with that, but there's a small little set of four books that were their forerunners of the Conflict of the Ages series, the big five-volume set that Ellen White wrote, called The Spirit of Prophecy. In Volume 2 in that series, it says this, page 285, "In the face of all his wonderful works, they turned away from him, who, by the beauty of his doctrine and his mercy and benevolence, had called thousands to his side, who had relieved suffering humanity so that entire cities and villages were freed from disease and there was no work for a physician among them." So, I mean, Jesus was like a healing river, just why did he do that? Didn't he spend his time preaching?
Well, do you heal someone to establish credibility and first, I'll heal you physically.
Mm-hmm.
Now, shall we talk about mental and spiritual health?
Mm-hmm.
And I would sure listen to a person who healed me physically for mental and spiritual.
Fair enough, yes.
Another maybe lesser answer to the question is what was going on in the world everywhere at that time? There was no radio. There were no newspapers.
No
television, no theater megaplexes.
It was tell a neighbor.
It was survival day by day.
Mm-hmm.
One's efforts were just trying to maintain life. Now comes along this miracle worker.
Mm-hmm.
This has got to be the hottest story.
Exactly.
Anywhere in the world.
Mm-hmm.
And it spreads like fire. So in one part, Jesus is calling everybody's attention to him.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and one of the things we don't talk about very much, But Ellen White mentions it specifically, and the New Testament mentions in a couple spots, people came from all the Gentile territories to be healed by Jesus. And I wonder what the Pharisees and Sadducees had to say about that when the crowds are full of Gentiles. And Jesus is healing them just like he's healing everybody else. Well, a couple of questions. Now, we're going to relate this. I mean, the goal is to relate this to us today, right? So we happen to live in the Mecca of Adventist healthcare called Loma Linda. We have an entity now which has recently changed its name. It's going to be called Loma Linda University Health, just four words. It now has six hospitals, eight schools. It cares for about 700 hospital patients per day, 1.5 million outpatients per year, and has more than 4,000 employees. More than 3/4 of our patients report 9 to 10 on their patient satisfaction surveys. Our patients come from all over the world, and our students come from 80 to 90 different countries. So this is a pretty big time operation. It's an international spot. Is it possible that we are still carrying on as our aim is, I believe, carrying on the healing and teaching ministry of Jesus Christ? Are we doing that?
Depends what you mean by that question.
Well, that's why I asked the question.
Well, I would hope that our patients, those patients that seek health care from the organization, would see something different than they would see at Cedars-Sinai or whatever mega hospital.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
When I was at a podiatrist's office, not an Adventist, I saw a Bible on the counter, which I don't see at Loma Linda. So mm-hmm.
There are Bibles around.
Yeah, and this was a non-Christian podiatrist.
Wow.
I mean, it was a non-Christian area, but the podiatrist put a Bible on his counter.
I see. Very good. Well, what does it mean to carry on the healing ministry? Let's focus on that for right now. What does it mean to carry on the healing ministry of Jesus Christ? Now, just a little side note. If you had told someone Jesus Day, look, hold up an x-ray or an MRI and say, here's where your problem is. See right here? Yeah, we looked through your body and we saw it here. Wouldn't they call that miraculous? Probably so. We have a lot of technologies today that do things that would have been considered miraculous in Jesus Day. So
what distinguishes us from Kaiser and the Mayo Clinic? Mm-hmm. What distinguishes us?
That's the question I'm asking. Are we carrying on? I mean, if we're just another healthcare institution, we might be doing a good job. You know, thank God we're here, but are we doing anything different than all the other people? I'm going to ask you a challenging question that I've asked a few times in the past in some of my classes. What would happen if a person like Jesus, or Jesus himself, would show up one morning and just walk through our hospital here and heal everybody completely? And I want to ask two questions. The first question is, how would it be reported in the newspapers?
It'd be a focus on the miracle, not...
Well, what would they say? Because most of those newspaper reporters don't believe that miracles are possible.
That seems a little bit of a contradiction. How can you have miracles and then not report them?
Well, I mean, I'm just telling you. Read the newspapers for yourself.
Hundreds think they are healed.
Yeah, that's a possibility.
Well, they report on the miracle of Mary crying blood on stone statues and stuff. So
well. Yeah,
well,
that's a little different kind of a miracle.
But
I mean,
still,
it would be pretty hard.
People are doing that.
Well, but it would be pretty hard if all the people in our hospital got up, perfectly healthy, and marched out and went home. it would be pretty hard for people to deny that something quite remarkable had happened.
Well, if that happened, would we be prepared to tell the newspaper people about our God and how our God made this possible? Or would we claim and say, we're a fabulous university and we have wonderful doctors who did this? So what would we be saying if this happened in our hospital? Yeah.
But since it hasn't happened, does that mean that we are not God's people, God's institution? No, it doesn't.
No, it doesn't. Yeah.
So I let me follow up on my next couple of questions. If that happened, would Loma Linda go out of business?
Absolutely not. We'd have to put barricades up for the people trampling the doors.
Exactly. The next day there would be every sick person from hundreds of miles around who could get here would be here. Yeah. So in the case of Jesus now, was his healing ministry, and this is my point now, or my question, was Jesus' healing ministry just a way of pulling people in?
No, because then he sat down and he gave a sermon. Mm-hmm. And he sat everybody down.
But he quit doing it at the end.
Why? He what?
He quit doing the healings at the end, and why?
He quit doing the healings at the end?
Yeah. In the end of his ministry, he wasn't doing.
And then
doing,
was it just sermons?
Well, I shouldn't say he quit doing healing completely, because one of his greatest miracles was one of the last things he did, raising Lazarus from the dead. So.
And he fixed an ear right at the very last.
That's true also. Yeah. Oh. Yeah.
One of the things that he asks us to do is to love our neighbor. Mm-hmm. And how do we love our neighbors? It's by ministering to their needs, mm-hmm. as he demonstrated. Mm-hmm. He went about people he was not acquainted with, strangers that were brought to him, mm-hmm. laid at his feet, as you just read, and he met their needs. He healed them. He fed them at times, and somehow I get the idea that when he asks us to be disciples, that if we really love our fellow neighbors, our mankind, that we ought to in some way be doing the same thing.
Meet their needs.
Right.
Yeah. Well, we are reminded, we have mentioned this many times in this class, that the Greek word for salvation, sozo, also means to heal. So to save is to heal in Greek. There wasn't a difference. It was just one word. Now there's something else of interest here, that talking about God's involvement, he talks about, and we suggest this a little bit ago, he says he's not only going to deal with our sickness and so he doesn't just get rid of them, but he's going to take our sins, which some feel that's the cause of our sicknesses, and he's going to bear them himself. Have you ever heard of a pagan god saying, please put your sins on me and I'll bear them for you?
I haven't met many pagan gods, so...
I'll bear them for you. For what purpose? Is that what gives you the salvation?
Well, some people would say yes. Mm-hmm. My sins are gone because Jesus took them. Yeah.
But that's a big difference between Christianity and all other religions. That God comes to us, and other religions, we have to seek to find him, mm-hmm. or his followers have to seek to find whatever God they're chasing.
What do we learn from the book of Job about sicknesses and people's attitude about sicknesses?
Well, we know that the people of Job's time, Job's friends, said, you must have some hidden sin. That's why you're having all these problems. That's why God has taken everything from you. That's why you're sick. Mm-hmm.
So the idea was, if you're a bad person, if you're sinning, then God can't bless you, and if God can't bless you, awful things will happen to you. If you're a good person, God will bless you, and then you drive a Mercedes, right? Something like that.
But that attitude is pretty easy to adopt. Mm-hmm. If you look at the Old Testament, absolutely. God claims responsibility for everything the good and the bad. Mm-hmm. And we have to understand those passages, I think, before we can really unravel this dichotomy.
What is really beautiful to see is to see God helping a person through sickness, and that person maintaining, keeping their attitude and still being benevolent and kind, even though you know they're suffering greatly. And to me, that is a huge witness as to the power of God to help that person through their mm-hmm. suffering. And that's a beautiful thing to see. You don't see that too many times, but yeah. I have known some people like that. They're real inspiration.
So, back to our question. Why do you think people came to Jesus? He's the walking hospital?
For the food.
For the food? A lot of them did. Look at John 6. There's a whole discussion of why they came.
Well, if you looked at God as a source, which he is, I mean, he's the creator. Everything's come from him. As soon as you find that out, wouldn't you just want to go to him? If you're sick or you lack something, wouldn't you want to go to him? Wouldn't you? I mean, that's the answer to your question. Mm-hmm. You might think that maybe some of them have some selfish desires inside. I don't know, but mm-hmm. but no matter what, God is the source of everything.
They would have to believe that he is God.
That's right. And so they must have believed that he was healing people.
No, they didn't believe it.
They didn't believe
he was God.
Well,
they were hoping he would be the Messiah. See, the Messiah would be the sent one. He would be someone sent from God, but not God himself.
Now, why would they not think he was connected with God if he was healing?
Well, connected with God is one thing. To say that he is God, that's another story.
But if you look at it, God gave, when he fed the 5,000, he passed out all the stuff to everybody else, and everybody else passed it on to everybody else, mm-hmm. and that kind of stuff. So you're actually saying the same thing with the people that are passing out things.
It's true. I don't think any of us would deny the fact that the miracles Jesus performed were quite remarkable, and they became, collectively, if you start adding up everything he was doing, you're going to say, wow, I mean, what else can you say? I mean, all the way to the point where finally he raises Lazarus from the dead, and, you know, then all the Jewish leaders are turned against him.
Well, still, the point is that if you're in a desert and you're dying of thirst, you're looking for water. Mm-hmm. If you see an oasis over there, you're going to go there.
Yep.
You're not going to go to the driest part of the,
no,
of
you're
the
right.
desert.
Yeah.
That's why they would come.
Yeah. Dennis.
Well, think of what life was like back then.
Yeah.
Maybe not different than third world countries today.
Some.
Where there is no medical care. So what happens if you get injured? What happens if you break an arm or a leg? Or worse, get hit in the eye with a stone or rock. What do you do?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you go back home and tough it out. It's the only thing you can do. And here was someone who would just touch you or speak to you, and you would be
perfectly well,
magically healed, just like that. Of course, they would come running.
Yeah. Well, there's the famous story found in Mark 2, and it's expanded on considerably in Ministry of Healing pages 73 through 77. Look at that story. A few days later, Jesus went back to Capernaum, and the news spread that he was at home. Now, let's stop for a second. I thought Jesus' home was in Nazareth. Why is this saying he goes to Capernaum, he's at home?
He got run out of Nazareth early in his
ministry. So where did he go?
Capernaum.
He went to Capernaum, or Capharnaum, as they would say. Literally, Capharnaum means the village of Nahum. That's where it gets its name. We don't know if this is the Nahum from the Old Testament or some other Nahum, but that's what the name means. And the place where Jesus called home at Capernaum, as far as we know, was the home of Peter. If you happen to visit the site of Capernaum, they've now excavated it quite extensively, you will discover that it's very likely that there's a house, a little bit of the foundation is still left, that was Peter's house, and it's right close to the seashore. And it was later, they built one church on it, and then later they built another church on top of that. So you're trying to look at three layers of stuff, but there it is. And go and see it today. So anyway, so he was at Peter's house, and so what happens? So many people came together that there was no room left, not even out in front of the door. Jesus was preaching the message to them when four men arrived carrying a paralyzed man to Jesus. Because of the crowd, however, they could not get the man to him. So they made a hole in the roof. Now, how would you do that? You can't get to the front door. How can you get to the roof?
Can we look at something here? Jesus was preaching the message to them when four men arrived carrying a sick person.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if we're to model Jesus, are our doctors preaching the message when people arrive with their sick people? Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And
hopefully.
I know when I came to this hospital in the 70s, the offices were full of literature we could read about. I learned who God was in the waiting rooms. And the doctors were preaching the message as we were carrying my mom there. So that to me was a model of what Jesus was doing. So he just wasn't healing. He was mm-hmm. preaching the message, and the people mm-hmm. brought people to him to be healed.
Yeah.
Literature and preaching is two different things.
Oh, no, it isn't. Oh, no, it isn't.
Yes, it is. One is text, and the other one is actual words.
The goal
words.
Is the same thing, though.
I know, but when you started asking that question, I started thinking, you know, if a person's sick, and you go over here, and you know you're going to get preached to, but over here, you know, you're going to get just healed. I think I'm going to go over there because I don't know if I want to be preached to or not.
My mom was baptized because of the literature.
Well,
she would not be in heaven if it wasn't for the literature.
I'm not going to argue with that.
And I consider that preaching.
I'm not.
And I am very grateful for whoever had that in the room.
Okay.
Because of that, I will have my mom in heaven.
But did you hear my question?
I don't consider verbal and printed a difference in preaching. Just like in a classroom, I don't consider the text on the textbook and the teacher saying something. It's all education. So we won't argue about that now. Continue.
Okay, because of the crowd, they couldn't get. Well, it turns out that these houses very often had external stairways. And so obviously that must have been what they did. They walked up the outside and got up on the roof. And here's Jesus preaching, and all of a sudden, hey, what's going on up there, you know?
Was this a thatch roof that they just separated?
Well, we don't know for sure. It's probably not thatch. It was probably some kind of plaster over timbers. And they presumably, I guess, must have pulled the plaster apart and pulled off some of the timbers. And I don't know what Peter thought of his house being torn down.
That sounds kind of destructive.
Yeah. Well, so what happened? They let the man down in front of Jesus, and seeing how much faith they had, Jesus said to the paralyzed man, "My son, your sins are forgiven." Now, did Jesus know what he was doing?
Absolutely, he knew what he was doing.
He knew exactly.
He wasn't experimenting.
This wasn't experimenting. And what was the response?
This is blasphemy, because only God can forgive sins.
But yet they believed that every sickness was a result of sin. So if this guy is going to be healed and he's already healed a whole bunch of other people, what's he doing?
It doesn't fit their...
They had a real problem with this. A real problem with this. See? And it, you know, we would say, oh, go ahead and heal him. It doesn't mean he has to be saved. We see these as more or less two different things, but they had them all one. So, of course, the teachers of the law were sitting there, thought to themselves, how does he dare to talk like this? This is a blasphemy. God is the only one who can forgive sins. And, of course, Jesus said, that's a bright smile. That's a great idea, right? I mean, of course, God is the only one who can forgive sins. And therefore,
I am.
He was God. Jesus God.
Let me see if I can make this guy completely well. Get up, take up your mat, and walk.
I don't think Jesus was operating as an experiment or see if he could prove something to himself. He knew what the end result was going to be.
Yeah, yeah.
So it sounds like he said in the name of God, rise.
No, he said it in his own name. He said,
you don't get my point.
Okay.
The thing is that when you say that, pick up your bed and walk, you're actually saying that you're God, aren't you?
Yeah.
So in meaning terms, even though he didn't say those words, it's the same thing.
He says specifically, so that I will prove to you then that the Son of Man, who's he talking about? Himself, has authority on earth to forgive sins. In other words, he's saying, like it or not, I am God. So he said to the paralyzed man, I tell you, get up, pick up your mat, and go home. And the crowd couldn't have been so dumb that they missed that. They must, a lot of people there must have realized. While they all watched, the man got up, picked up his mat, and hurried away. They were all completely amazed and praised God. Here we are back to the praising God, saying, we've never seen anything like this.
And the scribes, they had a real problem with that, didn't they?
Yes, they did.
Did the people know who Jesus meant when Jesus says the Son of Man?
Well, literally the expression Son of Man using Hebrew thought would mean this human being. This human being has the authority to forgive sins. Okay.
And some of the scribes were not honest people.
Yeah, yeah. Well, Ellen White goes on to explain that this man's disease was largely a result of his own sins. And he knew, of course, what had caused his sins, and he longed for spiritual healing most of all. And Christ met him at the point of his greatest need. It's also interesting to note that the Jewish people largely believed that the idea that sickness came from sin. So ultimately, in order to heal the sickness, one had to deal with the sin. Therefore, Christ met them where they were, and he did so by demonstrating the fact that he was God himself. And therefore, he could forgive sins, and he proved that by healing the man right in front of them.
And they did not celebrate.
They were amazed. They praised God.
No, I mean the Pharisees and scribes.
Oh, well, no, they didn't celebrate. They just realized they took a heavy blow. Well, notice a couple more things. The man himself had no power to come to Jesus. However, Ellen White told us that Jesus was aware of the man's condition and knew he was coming. It was in Peter's house Jesus was preaching when the group approached. Have you ever wondered exactly how they climbed on the roof? We talked about that. Did they repair the roof when they were done? Good question. What can we learn from Jesus' exchange with the teachers of the law who are present? Jesus proved to all who were willing to accept it that he had the power to forgive sins, and thus he was God. Ellen White goes on to say that the young man was so relieved to hear Jesus forgive his sins that he did not even hope for anything more. His physical healing was proof of concept. Yes, Dennis.
You mentioned that Jesus knew the man was coming.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes we say that if we really walked as closely with God as Jesus walked with God,
mm-hmm.
would we be aware of people coming to us before they ever arrived?
I think that's possible. I am becoming more and more convinced that Jesus every night prayed considerable periods of time, sometimes not so long, sometimes all night long, planning for what he was going to do the next day with the Father and with the Holy Spirit. And I'm sure that they revealed to Jesus, okay, tomorrow this and this and this and this is going to happen. He knew in advance. Amazing. Well, unfortunately, as in Jesus' day, despite our best efforts, every person will eventually die. Is that why Jesus always followed his healings with an attempt to point his parents to his patients to everlasting life? Okay, another story, Luke 8, 26 to 39. I don't know if we should take time to read the whole story. In fact, I would like to expand this story considerably. What happened? Well, Jesus got in a boat for some reason. We don't know why. I mean, obviously he knew what he was doing. They traveled across the Sea of Galilee, not headed to any particular place as far as we know. He gets to the other side. He runs into one or possibly two demon-possessed people who are ready to tear them apart, Jesus and all the disciples. And the disciples go running off, and Jesus says, they realize Jesus wasn't with them. They turned around, what was Jesus? He was standing there. And he cast those demons out, cast them in a herd of pigs. The herd of pigs rushed down the bank of the sea and into the water, drowning. And what happened next?
And the demon-possessed men then were healed.
The demon-possessed men then were healed.
Their demons were gone into the pigs and into the lake?
Yep.
Or ocean?
Which would make me wonder whether the Jews dared to eat any of the fish they got out of that lake for the next month or two. anyway.
Why did the demons have to be in an animal or a human? It doesn't make any sense to me.
Why did Jesus give them permission to go there?
I suspect that the demons did this because they realized what was going to happen. Everybody was like, you know, they came back to Jesus, and they said, please leave our territory, you destructive character.
You're ruining our economy.
You're ruining our economy. And that's exactly what the devil wanted. But he hadn't accounted on what Jesus was going to do next, which was what? The two demon-possessed men, they had been through enough. And they said to Jesus, please let us go with you. And what did Jesus say?
Stay here.
And do what?
Tell your neighbors, your friends.
Go and tell your story. Which, by the way, makes them the first missionaries sent by Jesus to a Gentile territory. Former demon-possessed men with what? An hour or two of exposure to Jesus?
What about Abraham? He was sent as a missionary to a Gentile territory.
Yeah, I guess technically, yes, that would be
But true. Not sent by Jesus, I guess.
Not sent directly by Jesus, no. Well, what happened a short time later? And, of course, that's the time that our lesson talks about. A short time later, maybe a matter of two or three months, Jesus came back to that territory, and what happened? Thousands and thousands of people rushed out to meet him. And what did they expect to find?
Miracles.
Well, they wanted to know who did that to these demon-possessed men that mm-hmm. had been running around the community for years and years, and now mm-hmm. were upstanding citizens.
Mm-hmm. And what was the result? Not only a lot of people were healed, but the gospel was carried to a pagan territory. Or Gentile Terry anyway, and large, partly pagan anyway. I'm sure there were plenty of Jews that lived in that area as well. But
the story suggests that the people were there for 3 days listening to Jesus preach. Mm-hmm. And they ran out of food. Mm-hmm. So what did Jesus do?
Okay, so, and this wasn't the first time Jesus had fed a large crowd. When had he fed a large crowd before this?
Fed the 5,000 Jews
yes.
a short time before.
And if you happen to know, if I could draw a map of the Sea of Galilee, it goes a little bit like that. The place where he said fed the 5,000, I guess would be, if you're looking at the map, it would be over on this side, just almost into the Gentile territory, in near Bethsaida, is where they were, and he fed the 5,000 there, and then just a little ways over, he fed, in the Gentile territory, he fed the 4,000, two spots very close together. But now, whereas in the Jewish territory, he had five loaves and two fishes, and when he got done, what was left?
12 baskets.
12 baskets. How many tribes are there in Judaism or in the Hebrew nation? There were 12, a basket for every tribe. How many Canaanite nations were populating the area of Decapolis in those days? Can you try to name them? Well, we don't need
to name
them.
Is that a Jeopardy question?
Yeah. It's a Jeopardy question.
There were seven.
There were seven. There were seven. And the baskets they gathered from the fourth feeding of the 4,000 were a completely different kind of basket, a much larger basket. And they gathered seven baskets for the seven Canaanite nations. Mm. What an interesting situation.
Amazing.
Yeah.
So Jesus wants them all.
Yeah. Yeah.
7 and 12 is a pretty biblical number.
Those are biblical numbers, absolutely. Yeah. Well, okay, back to our question about healing. Loma Linda has come to be known as a blue zone. We don't spend a long time about that. There was an article about it on National Geographic, and there's been movies and things on TV about it. What's a blue zone?
A healthy zone.
Okay.
I thought it was Democrats.
No, it's
a
communities in which longevity is quite prominent. The people live to be
unusual.
That's right.
Yeah, and this guy that went to, did the research found four places in the world, and Loma Linda is the only one in North America.
You know, it really can't be said Loma Linda. It has to really be said Seventh-day Adventist, because all the retirees come here with their good health habits, and they live to their ripe old age here. So Loma Linda is do you know what I mean? They could be coming from Maine or Oregon.
It's true.
It's the end zone.
But the interesting thing is, the interesting thing is that we live in one of the worst places of health in the entire nation. The only part of the country that has worst health statistics than San Bernardino area is Detroit.
Wow. Hmm.
So we have a little tiny blue island in the middle of a sea of red.
So the economy here is among the worst, and the health is also among the worst?
And why is that? There's the use of drugs, street drugs, is among the worst. The number of killings and murders and that kind of stuff is among the worst. Yeah. Well, so...
So we need to witness more, huh?
Yeah. Well, look at these words from Ellen White. Each day has its burdens, its cares, and perplexities, and when we meet, how ready we are to talk about our difficulties and trials. So many borrowed troubles intrude, so many fears are indulged, such a weight of anxiety is expressed, that one might suppose we had no pitying, loving Savior ready to hear all our requests and to be to us a present help in every time of need. Well, is one of the reasons why people here live longer because we have a Sabbath, that we rest every week? Mm-hmm. Is it because, of course, most of us don't drink, we don't smoke, we don't have a history of smoking. Some of us were former drinkers and smokers before we became Adventists. But does it promote longevity to have a trusting relationship with God?
Sure.
It does. I mean, there's plenty of evidence for that.
Also, the great controversy theory gives you a peace about what's happening in the world, and it lessens your anxiety. Mm-hmm. When you look at the big picture and you sort of know what's going on. A lot of my friends are very perplexed and anxious about the state of the world.
Yeah, something was pointed out to me just this last week that's scary as can be. And let me just report that to you for thinking about it. Traditionally, bank interest rates have been around 6%. Okay. The U.S. government is now paying approximately 16% of its GDP that comes to it, or it comes to the government, not the GDP, it's actually tax receipts, about 16% of tax receipts in interest, because we're paying what percentage now in interest? Approximately 1%.
If that, lower, yeah.
What would happen if we all of a sudden had to pay 6% again? Our entire tax income would go just to pay interest on our debt. There would be no money to operate our government at all.
The anarchy.
Okay, well, let's go back to the story of Jesus. There are three brief accounts. One's found in Luke 7, 11 to 17. Another is found in Mark 5, 21 to 43. And the third is found in John 11, almost the entire chapter, if you read the whole story. And these are the three accounts in the Gospels of Jesus raising people from the dead. And they are Jairus' daughter. He was one of the temple authorities in Capernaum. And as he saw his daughter dying, he realized there's only one person around that could do anything about it at that point in time. And even though he was one of the authorities from the temple, and I'm sure in very close cahoots with Pharisees and Sadducees, etc., he said, when my daughter's dying, I'm calling on Jesus, right? Which is an interesting point. Then the second one was?
The son of the widow of Nain.
The son of the widow of Nain. Very interesting situation. The bier was being carried down the hill from this town that was more or less up on a small hill, and it was being carried out of the city. And of course, mother was weeping because she was a widow, and this was her only child, and now she was completely on her own. And that everybody from town is marching down this thing to take this casket out to bury it, and Jesus comes along with his disciples and knows what's exactly going on. And what does he do? Walks over and says, hold on. They stop. He says, young man, get up. Can you imagine? I mean, when I think about this, it just blows me away. I'm thinking about a patient I saw just a few hours ago in the clinic. And this man has had all sorts of problems in his life, including probably a long history of drug use and so forth. And he comes in asking for things that I sometimes hesitantly give him, more pain meds and whatever that he needs. But I've taken to trying to reach out to them in various ways, and I've prayed for him. And it's very interesting. This guy is huge. He's big and tall. And I prayed for him again today, and he said, bye, I need to leave before I start crying. I thought that's a very interesting response. Mm-hmm. Very interesting response. Mm-hmm. Well, the third story of miraculous healing was?
Lazarus. Lazarus raising from the dead.
And what do we know about that story?
It sort of went along with the parable that Jesus taught about a man named Lazarus.
Mm-hmm.
And Jesus was not talking about this Lazarus, but Jesus maybe knew he was going to raise a man named Lazarus.
Well,
I find it strange. That's not a common name.
It was a fairly common name among the Jews. And I just realized that my computer has kicked my program out here. But anyway, so obviously, all you out there and all of us here pretty much have an idea of this story and what happened. There's some interesting aspects of this story. The Pharisees have been trying to eliminate Jesus since like his second year of ministry. They were doing everything they could to discredit him, to eliminate him, to do whatever they could possibly do. But the Sadducees had always kept themselves more or less aloof. They thought, you know, this uneducated Galilean, he's not going to upset our apple cart in any way. We're in charge down here. We're not going to let him bother us. But what was their belief about what happens to a person when he dies?
They're gone.
They're gone permanently. Okay? And that's the end of them. There's no resurrection, there's no life after death. And when Jesus raised Lazarus right within a couple miles of their headquarters in Jerusalem, and many people, there was no way to deny, and there's no way to deny he was dead. It was 4 days he'd been dead, and hundreds of people had probably been there. And I mean, he came from a very prominent family. What are you going to do if you're a Sadducee?
Are you saying that Jesus disrupted their theory about death?
Very much so. And now all of a sudden, not only the Pharisees, but all the past Sadducees are all of a sudden determined to get rid of this guy. And Jesus knew that after that, it wouldn't be long before They would find a way to kill him.
So even though Jesus was going per the Bible, just that because he upset their apple cart, they wanted to get rid of him, both the Pharisees and the Sadducees. I mean, Jesus was doing nothing but following the Bible.
Well, yeah.
Their whole economic system was in jeopardy.
Their whole
they had a monopoly on whatever they were doing, and now you got somebody feeding thousands of people, raising the dead.
Well, I think this is an example of anger. I mean, we keep thinking that they're kind of crazy, but I think it's really the product of anger. They at the beginning foretold, you know, that this guy's going to be nothing, that he's really from the devil and all this stuff, and it just keeps going against them more and more, and they get angrier and angrier and angrier until.
But Gary, don't you think it was jealousy that drove their anger?
Well, yes, yes. Anger comes from all kinds of different directions.
Yeah. It is interesting to notice that Lazarus, according to Ellen White, was a nephew of Simon the Pharisee, who was healed of leprosy by Jesus. So he belonged to a very prominent family. He was a close relative. And Mary, Martha, and Lazarus may have themselves been originally Pharisees. Very interesting idea. So,
you mean a family from the Pharisees?
Yeah.
So what was the real reason for Jesus to heal? You asked that question earlier and never really answered.
I was hoping you would answer it for me.
Well, near the end of your handout, it says, for the purpose of making it possible for people to think more clearly and thus better understand the plan of salvation.
Ah.
And that's very, very significant. I hope we'll all recognize that the purpose of healing was not just to attract people to his meetings. Jesus was healing people because he wanted them to understand, to be able to think more clearly, not to be just totally consumed by their pain or their disability. He wanted them to focus on, and everything, the illustrations he used in the sermon, everything was supposed to get people to focus their attention on the truths he was teaching. And even in his healing process, he would do it in ways that would get people to focus on the kingdom of heaven. And we need to figure out better ways to do that in our healing ministry in 2013. Think about it.